Welcome to St Mary's Merton for this weekly online worship. Today's gospel theme directs our gaze to the gift of sight, its recovery, as well as the grace of spiritual insight also. So now, as we prepare to begin our worship, let's use another of the senses we are blessed with and listen to our opening music, played with a flourishing touch on the organ of Rochdale Town Hall, the Jig Fugue by J.S. Bach.
Thank you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord be with you. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. As we prepare ourselves to celebrate these sacred mysteries, let us first call to mind and confess our sins. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, by whose Spirit the whole body of the Church is governed and sanctified, hear our prayer which we offer for all your faithful people, that in their vocation and ministry they may serve you in holiness and truth to the glory of your name. Through our Lord and Saviour Jesus Christ, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. A reading from the first letter of Peter, chapter 3, beginning at the 8th verse. Finally, all of you, have unity of spirit, sympathy, love for one another, a tender heart,
and a humble mind. Do not repay evil for evil, or abuse for abuse, but, on the contrary, repay with a blessing. It is for this that you were called, that you might inherit a blessing. For those who desire life and desire to see good days, let them keep their tongues from evil and their lips from speaking deceit. Let them turn away from evil and do good. Let them seek peace and pursue it. For the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are open to their prayer. But the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. Now, who will harm you if you are eager to do what is good? But even if you do suffer for doing what is right, you are blessed. Do not fear what they fear, and do not be intimidated, but in your hearts sanctify Christ as Lord. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke. As Jesus approached Jericho, A blind man was sitting by the roadside begging. When he heard a crowd going by, he asked what was happening. They told him, "Jesus of Nazareth is passing by." Then he shouted, "Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me." Those who were in front sternly ordered him to be quiet, but he shouted even more loudly, "Son of David, have mercy on me." Jesus stood still and ordered the man to be brought to him. And when he came near, he asked him, "What do you want me to do for you?" He said, "Lord, let me see again." Jesus said to him, "Receive your sight. Your faith has saved you." Immediately he regained his sight and followed him, glorifying God. And all the people, when they saw it, praised God. He entered Jericho and was passing through it. A man was there named Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was rich. He was trying to see who Jesus was, but on account of the crowd, he could not, because he was short in stature. So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore tree to see him, because he was going to pass that way. When Jesus came to the place, he looked up and said to him, "Zacchaeus, hurry and come down, for I must stay at your house today." So he hurried down and was happy to welcome him. All who saw it began to grumble and said, "He has gone to be the guest of one who is a sinner." Zacchaeus stood there and said to the Lord, "Look, half of my possessions, Lord, I will give to the poor. And if I have defrauded anyone of anything, I will pay back four times as much." Then Jesus said to him, "Today salvation has come to this house, because he too is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek out and to save the lost." This is the Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
Sight and foresight is the recurring theme in today's Gospel reading. Taking the 12 aside, Jesus prepares them for his impending death and rising from the grave. The blind man on the road to Jericho begs Jesus to have mercy on him and to recover his sight. Zacchaeus, being short in stature, climbs the sycamore tree in order the better to see him. And in the end, all three are rewarded with clearer vision. This seems a good model of the Christian life, that we might see more clearly. See the benefits that Christ has won for us, the pains and insults that he bore for us, and to see that the way we should tread in the company of our Redeemer, friend and brother. And to do all this in order, as the prayer has it, that we might know God more clearly, love him more dearly, and follow more nearly day by day. At a physical level, we know the importance of our eyes. Anyone who wears glasses or lenses, even more so. And how obscure the world appears without them. Beauty is fuzzy, and everything lacks distinction. And if, like me, you put your glasses down somewhere unusual, you have a job and a half often to find them. But we are fortunate in having opticians to help correct the fault, and in many cases, but sadly not all, restore our sight. And anyone who's had cataracts will know how transforming is the difference when they're removed. The veil is lifted, and light once again enters the eye unclouded, and the world takes on a whole new, sharper look. Let us then be thankful for the gift of sight, and be especially mindful of those whose own sight cannot be improved, and may even possibly deteriorate further. While we ponder this, I'm reminded of speaking to an elderly parishioner the other day who has virtually gone blind, and who told me that while saddened, of course, to lose most of his sight, it has opened him to a door, the door to talking books, which have been a lifeline for him. And among the titles he's avidly listened to, some by C.S. Lewis, including his famous work Mere Christianity, which, had it not been for needing talking books, he said, I might never have received his wisdom. But when we shift to thinking about our inner spiritual sight, our vision and guiding inner light, let's not divorce the two and think that the spiritual is all that matters, and that physical sight somehow is second order. It wasn't like that for our Lord. When he encountered the physically blind man, even though he was busy discoursing with his 12 disciples at a critical time in his ministry, he broke off from that spiritual work and allowed himself to be interrupted and dealt with the blind man's physical sight there and then in their midst. It was this concern that people should be able to see and have other basic health care provided that inspires the charity Mercy Ships, which we've supported for about 6 years now, and I'm pleased to say the Finance Committee just the other week, this week, has authorised the sending of the balance we promised to them, so that despite the current pressures on our finances, which are as nothing compared to theirs, we've continued with our giving, which is all thanks to all of you who continue to support St Mary's. Thank you. The charity, as you may know, bought a ship and converted it into a floating hospital, sailing into ports mainly along the west coast of Africa, providing operations to thousands of those who have no such health service. Life-saving operations that restore people's ability to work and earn their living and provide for their families, removing cataracts, and also training nurses from among the local population and providing basic toilet facilities and clean water, without which, as we know, no one is going to remain healthy for long. No wonder its strapline is hope on the horizon. So let us then continue to remember Mercy Ships and its huge number of volunteer doctors, nurses and support staff who give up months of their time to board the ship and offer their services for free. Have mercy upon me, O Jesu, Son of David, was the cry of the blind man, and the same cry should at regular intervals be ours too. Have mercy upon me, a sinner, and have mercy upon me for my ingratitude and self-preoccupation. May your grace help me see what I need to make me whole, what clearer vision I need to follow more faithfully on the way. And when we do pray the Kyrie, Lord and Christ have mercy, may we be stirred no less than was the blind man and Zacchaeus, so we too should be prepared to respond. Metaphorically, to muster the energy to climb that sycamore tree, that we might too the better see our Lord and learn his ways. We can't expect the clear vision to land on our laps like a pair of unsolicited glasses arriving through the post. There is work to be done, pleas of mercy to well up within us and find expression in our prayerful cries. Trees to climb, that our vision of Christ is not obscured by things that distract our pilgrim progress. There is prayerful listening to be done at the feet of our Lord and in pondering his will, as the 12 disciples did, and we can all be part of that ministry. And like the early disciples who followed Christ, we should be prepared too to contemplate a road with some hardships ahead of us. They were not promised a smooth conveyor belt to glory. Jesus spelt out the mocking shame that would be meted out to him. But even in the face of that impending fate, he still, unflinching, stayed the course and faced with courage the outcome that was before him. To see the danger looming and not run away takes courage. More courage, even, than the instinctive adrenaline response to an emergency, say, that springs upon us. Jesus contemplated the flogging and his passion, yet he still pressed on, that on the third day he would rise again. To see Christ as he really is and to have the clouds of obscurity lifted from before our eyes is a life-transforming experience. As the stained glass panel above the high altar depicts, when a boy who was going to go blind was spared to see another day. To see things clearly and to set our course focused on Christ will cause us, like Zacchaeus, to hear the great words of Christ addressed personally to us also. They are comfortable words, but they do not come cheap, for they were bought with the sacrifice of his life, lived and offered for us all. Today, he says, salvation has come to this house. What greater accolade could we ever hope to hear? Amen.
Let us profess our faith. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures, He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us pray.
Lord, in your compassionate understanding of what it is to be human, hear our prayers. Use them and us to bring new peace, joy, love and hope into the lives of those for whom we are praying and with whom we have contact day by day. You bless us with many gifts. Help us to use them as we have opportunity. May we seek above all to have love that is patient and kind, not jealous or proud. Help us to let go of past wrongs which may have been hurtful to us, seeking above all to have love that protects and trusts and hopes, love that forgives and keeps on forgiving. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray, Lord, for your church throughout the world, especially at this time of uncertainty and anxiety. May its ministers and all who represent the church day by day be especially sensitive to the often unexpected needs of those around us at this difficult time. You call us to be your messengers, so through our outreach and deeds, may we reflect your love and compassion for all. We pray for our Archbishop Justin, our bishops Christopher and Richard, and especially give thanks for our priests John and Judith, who have nourished us in our faith through virtual services and suggested prayers and readings when we have been unable to meet Sunday by Sunday. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray, Lord, for world leaders and all who advise them, particularly in relation to the pandemic. For scientists and all in the medical profession who have to make difficult assessments based on day-to-day statistics, whilst also striving to find solutions sometimes involving worldwide cooperation to beating this very contagious infection. We continue to give thanks for the selfless dedication of key workers in our hospitals and care homes, in our transport networks, and those who keep essential services running. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord Jesus, who went about doing good and healing all, we ask you to bless all who are sick, suffering or dying. Give them strength in body, courage in spirit, and patience with pain. We remember all who have COVID-19, and in our own community we pray for those on our intercession list to be found on the pew sheet. We pray for families who are separated from loved ones who are ill or dying. We give thanks for those who have recovered from any illness. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Grant, Lord, refreshment, light, and peace to those who no longer need the bread of this world. Receive them into their eternal home. We pray too for those who mourn. To those who have died, rest eternal grant unto them, O Lord, and let light perpetual shine upon them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Rejoicing in the fellowship of the Blessed Virgin Mary and all the saints, we commend ourselves and the whole creation to your unfailing love. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
We are the body of Christ. In the one Spirit we were all baptized into one body. Let us then pursue all that makes for peace and builds up our common life. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Let us offer one another a sign of peace. Thank you to all of you who are able to continue with your planned giving and offerings in support of this church and the work of the church throughout the diocese. Yours, Lord, is the greatness, the power, the glory, the splendour and the majesty. For everything in heaven and on earth is yours. All things come from you, and of your own do we give you. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Father, we give you thanks and praise through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, your living Word, through whom you have created all things, who was sent by you in your great goodness to be our Saviour. By the power of the Holy Spirit he took flesh. As your Son, born of the Blessed Virgin, he lived on earth and went about among us. He opened wide his arms for us on the cross. He put an end to death by dying for us and revealed the resurrection by rising to new life. So he fulfilled your will and won for you a holy people. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and singing. Lord, you are holy indeed, the source of all holiness. Grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit, and according to your holy will, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who in the same night that he was betrayed, took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. And so, Father, calling to mind his death on the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. As we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send the Holy Spirit on your people, and gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we in the company of all the saints may praise and glorify you for ever through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, Almighty Father, for ever and ever. Amen. As our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and for ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Draw near with faith. Receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood, which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. The body of Christ. Amen. The blood of Christ. Amen.
Let us pray. Grant, O Lord, we beseech you, that the course of this world may be so peacefully ordered by your governance, that your church may joyfully serve you in all godly quietness, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. I commend to you the notices this week, which can be found on the weekly pew sheet on our website. There you'll find the most up-to-date information, including about the pattern of resumed services in church, which we are planning to hold in the weeks and months ahead, while still providing this online worship. With thanks to everyone who's had a hand in preparing today's liturgies, both online and in church. So let us now join together as we sing our final hymn. The peace of God, which passes all understanding. Keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.